Right, so welcome again. This is the first talk of this pre-NLLP seminar we're starting. And today the speaker is Ilias Chalkidis, who will be presenting his work on paragraph level rationale extraction through regularization. And this is a paper that has already been accepted at NACL 2021. Ilias has just completed his PhD on legal NLP in the Department of Informatics, Athens University of Economics and Business. He has also worked for Cognitive Plus, which is a startup specializing on processing of legal and business documents. And Ilias has also worked, and I think is still working, technically speaking, for the Ernst & Young Center of Excellence in Document Intelligence at NCSR Democritus in Athens. His work has considered applications such as information extraction from contracts and legal judgment prediction, large-scale, multi-scale, multi-label text classification. And he will soon be joining the Coastal Group in the Department of Computer Science at the University of Copenhagen as a postdoctoral research. And I think his plans are to continue working on legal NLP and especially targeting interpretability and fairness. Today we also have Gijs van Dijck with us. Gijs is a professor of empirical legal research at Maastricht University and director of the Maastricht Law and Tech Lab. Gijs will be our discussant today, so I hope he will help us ask Ilias difficult questions or point out interesting points about the work of Ilias. But we will also invite questions from the audience. Gijs has taught courses on contract law, property law, but he's also involved in empirical legal research and computational legal research. So he sort of knows both sides. And we thank you, Gijs, very much for joining us today. So I think, Ilias, you can start the presentation. We plan for a 40 minutes presentation, and then probably 20 minutes discussion, and maybe also then questions from the audience.
Okay. Hello, everyone. I think you see my screen, right?
Yes.
Someone muted me. Okay. Today I'm going to present an overview of our recent article on paragraph level rationale extraction for European Court of Human Rights cases. So I think a big fundamental question is why explainability matters at all. And I think the first quite obvious answer in my mind, at least, is that there is evidence of the responsible deployment of the AI system and how this can affect human lives. So research explainable models can potentially offer solutions to expose and mitigate some of these issues and promote fairness and accountability. So while there are several studies of bias in AI in general, in the legal domain that we mainly care about here today, we could distinguish the work of Anguin et al. And Dressel and Farid, who examined the issue for crime recidivism assessment systems used by law enforcement in USA. And actually, Anguin et al. Found that there is a clear bias towards Black people from the system who assessed with a higher score, while Dressel and Farid further backed up these findings with their own study, where COMPASS, a system was found to be no better than untrained human or linear classifier using a few naive features, while also the ratio of false positives for Black people was much higher than this of white folks. So explanations can potentially be a valuable tool to diagnose and mitigate bias, and this is why we care about most. And in this direction, explanatory methods can be used to identify issues and help us debug and reinforce our models to elevate these issues and build better models with respect to fairness. So Another important issue is to demystify models' reasoning to improve trustworthiness and lead to a larger and more knowledgeable adaptation of technology by end users. So explanation should be probably a core part of assistive predictive tools like those that are used by decision makers, legal scholars, or researchers in general to assist their work. And last and foremost, people have the right to explanation, as we all know, and such methods could potentially provide the means to provide answers. The last thing I would like to say is that all formulation issues and potential solutions subject to over systemic bias and power structure. So in other words, our models learn from our data. And we just try to babysit our models against our legacy. And maybe it's hard to do this if we ignore the larger issues. So moving forward, here we see a figure from our previous work where we actually examined the performance of neural models predicting human rights violation of European Court of Human Rights cases, considering the fact of a case. Here we see the attention weights that are provided by a hierarchical attention network. So we see attention scores in the word level across a paragraph and attention scores in between paragraphs that could possibly lead to the predictive outcome that we had. So in this specific example, we see that high importance scores have been assigned in a few words that denote injuries, which seem to be kind of a reasonable explanation for the predictive outcome. Although we have also high scores that have been assigned in several words that express demographics and shouldn't play any role at all. So in fact, considering the structure of the text, I would say that paragraph level explanations seem more suitable in this specific scenario. And paragraphs are usually self-contained and represent facts in chronological order in this specific setup. Although, as we observed in this example, without any special consideration, the setup will lead to incomprehensible results. For example, we see here that the first paragraph is considered very important, while it's not. So the goal is to follow the literature on explainability to improve this kind of explanations. So we decided to follow the path of rationale extraction, where the goal is to extract a subset of inputs which support the corresponding output. In all recent methods, the model needs to be explainable by design, which actually means that the model has to provide rationales, contrary to other approaches in explainability and interpretability, where one has to derive explanation in a post hoc manner using gradient-based or other kind of methods. So here we see some examples for word-level rationale extraction from the literature, where the models have tried to extract the most prominent words to justify product reviews. In the left part, we see some B reviews and kind of explanation for different aspects. And the right side, we also see a kind of explanation for a positive or a negative outcome for Amazon reviews. So in this work, we again will experiment with a data comprising court case from the European Court of Human Rights. And similar to our previous work, each case is represented with a list of actual paragraphs as we see here. We consider a very similar task where our goal here is to predict which articles of the human rights provision have been discussed in this case instead of identifying those that have been violated. For example, in this case, the court considered Article 3 and 5, which has been allegedly violated according to the applicant. And considering the possible violation of these two articles only, the court found that indeed both articles were actually violated by the defendant states. So in order to rule this case, the court described its reasoning in a written formal assessment discussing all possible allegedly violated articles, where there are also references to the factual paragraphs that we see on the left side. And here, we are going to use this reference as a proxy to evaluate the quality of rationales extracted by some examined models. In other words, our assumption is that the core provided these specific references for the most prominent facts to support or not the allegations. And as we already said, this is just a proxy, so it's a silver set of annotations. So we will also consider gold annotations provided by a legal expert in a subset of 50 cases. So to give some idea on the dataset includes 11,000 cases ordered in a chronological order, meaning that the older cases are used for training, while the newest one comprised the test set. And actually recent studies show that temporal splits are more realistic as we do not overestimate real performance contrary to random split or standard splits that may be provided in other cases. So as we see in the table, across all cases, the court discussed on average 1 to 2 allegedly violated articles. And we see in the plot that the label distribution is highly skewed in favor of 5 to 10 articles among the 40 violable articles. And another interesting fact that we will also consider in our experiments is that the 30% of the facts on average are referred in the court assessment. So without further ado, I will move to the model description. So across experiments, we will use a baseline model, which is a hierarchical variant of BERT. In other words, we will feed the model with a sequence of factual paragraphs. So initially, a shared BERT encoder encode each factual paragraph independently to produce the initial paragraph embeddings. And at this point, paragraphs embeddings are unaware of context, meaning that the fellow paragraphs in the case have not been considered. So then we feed the sequence of the initial paragraph embeddings in a shallow transformer with 2 layers. And this layer aims to capture cross-paragraph relation and contextualize paragraph embeddings. So then we project the contextualized paragraph embeddings in 2 separate spaces. The first projection layer with the yellow color, as you see in the figure, will produce the query paragraph embeddings that will be used to extract the rationale, actually a selection of paragraphs. While the other one in aquamarine color will produce the query paragraph embeddings that will be later used to represent the case. So here we see that the query paragraph embeddings are fed in the hard attention layer in order to produce the rationale, which is actually a binary mask where ones indicate that the paragraph is considered important or 0 otherwise. And given this binary mask and the key paragraph embeddings, the key paragraph embeddings are masked, and then we use max pooling to produce the final case representation, which is then is classified using a final classification layer with 40 outputs. I remind you that 40 is the number of articles that we consider that are violable at all. So the parameters of this network can be updating considering the classification loss of allegedly violation prediction. But although in this case, an unregulated hard attention layer will quickly degenerate, produce 1 for all paragraphs to benefit classification performance. Hence, the literature of rationale extraction proposes the use of regularizers to regulate hard attention with respect to different constraints. So obviously, the main classification task plays the most important role in our case, and in any case, and the model has to be accurate in predicting the correct labels, even considering a subset of the paragraphs instead of the full text. A first fundamental constraint proposed in the literature is sparsity, meaning that the reasonable mask shall only consider a small subset of the original input, respecting a predefined threshold in relation to the length of the input. In our case, this is the number of the paragraphs, and we may target 30 or 20% of the original input. Also, another broadly used constraint is continuity, which encourages the selection of continuous elements from the input, which means actually that we encourage one paragraph after the other to be used instead of sparse selections. So while in the literature, these elements are words, here are, as I said, paragraphs. And hence, we hypothesize that possibly this constraint will not benefit the model. Also, another recently proposed regularizer is comprehensiveness, where the model shall include all informative elements of the input in the rationale. And this is formulated as a minimax game where the model shall make better decisions considering the predicted rationale rather than its complement given a predefined threshold again. As we see in the right panel, all these constraints are in fact regularizers formulated as additional losses, and we add up all of those to comprise the total loss of the model. So here I can give you a depiction of the model using sparsity and continuity loss with respect to the binary mask produced by the hard attention layer, while also we have the comprehensiveness loss comparing the classification loss of the original model in the lower part with a classification loss of another classification layer, which consider the complement of the predicted binary mask. In fact, as we said, the whole setup is a minimax game where both classifiers try to optimize their performance and be better, while the one in the lower part shall remain on top of the other. So moving a step forward, we propose two alternative formulations for comprehensiveness. And also in a similar direction with comprehensiveness, we propose a new constraint where a model can only produce a mask, which leads to better predictions comparing to its complement. But actually, the predicted mask shall be better than any other mask. So in order to approximate this configuration, we compare at each training step the outcome given the predicted mask with the outcome given a randomly generated mask, which possibly overlap with the predicted mask as well. So again, this can be formulated with all three variants that we consider and propose for comprehensiveness. So I will only show the last variant of comprehensiveness. Here we see that instead of comparing the losses of the model, we can actually do another thing and compare the document representations where these different players rely on. And as we see, in case of singularity loss, what happens is that you can think that we have kind of an evil wizard throwing random mask in our model, and the models have faced this challenge and remain on top of its opponent, even where the masks overlap with the original mask. So following the model description, I hope it was adequate, and the examined alternatives that we quickly overview, I will review the evaluation framework, which is also important. And in this work, we do not only target, of course, classification performance, which will be measured by everyone's score, but we also care for other aspects like things that are relevant for rationales. So we want our models to correctly approximate, first of all, the predefined sparsity threshold. In our case, we will try to approximate a 30% threshold ratio, because this was the average ratio of select paragraphs in the silver rationales. And secondly, we would also like to our predicted rationales to reflect the true reasoning of the model in the highest possible degree. This kind of quality is called faithfulness in the literature. So in order to evaluate faithfulness, we will consider two measures proposed by Dijck et al. From the literature, which are named, again, comprehensiveness and sufficiency. So just to grasp an idea for this kind of measure for faithfulness, both rely on comparing the original model predictions and its performance with either the model's prediction considering only the predicted rationale, which means that the model this time will only have access to the rationale and not the rest of the paragraphs. And in the second case, we compare with a model that only has access to the complement of the predicted rationales. So intuitively and ideally, we would like to get identical prediction for the one considering only the rationale and worse prediction for the one considering the complement, which follows pretty much the kind of the game we played with our models. And lastly, to evaluate the quality of predicted rationales, in other words, to examine how accurately they approximate silver all gold rationales, we will use mean R precision in F1 by comparing the predicted rationales with the annotations. So first of all, let's quickly review the classification performance. And here we see the performance of a baseline model excluding the hard attention masking across altitudes. So we observe that the scores are higher for some altitudes, first of all, especially those which are in the dark green frame on the left side. And there are mainly two reasons for this outcome. First, there is, of course, a sufficient number of cases regarding this article that would explain this result. And also the interpretation application of these articles is more fact dependent than those of other articles. So that such of 8 to 11 articles, if you see, have worse results because they are less fact dependent. On the other hand, although there is a fair amount of training instances for some other articles, those that are included in the red frame, these articles are triggered by legal procedural technicalities, and hence their performance is very low, despite that the fact that they have a kind of a lot of training instances. So exploring the newly proposed variants for comprehensiveness and singularity, we found that comparing the document representation has the best rationale quality considering comprehensiveness loss. But although considering the singularity loss, targeting the label probabilities provide the best rationale quality. We suspect that in singularity loss, where we use random masks that may overlap with a predicted mask, trying to enforce this kind of dissimilarity between the document representations actually lead to a harsh regularizer with negative effects, and may this actually explain the results. So following, we will see classification and faithfulness results. So comparing the classification performance across methods using the different regularization strategies, we observe that all methods are comparable and slightly outperformed by a baseline model called hierarchical bell toll, as we said before, which consider the full input. We also observe that all variants are able to successfully respect the 30% sparsity threshold, which is good. And also considering the result across the faithfulness measures, we observe that the newly proposed constraint singularity has the best results, even compared to a strong baseline, which is supervised with silver rationales, which means that actually this model tried to optimize its rationales considering the silver ones. So singularity also provide the best results in rationale quality measures when compared the predicted rationales with either silver or gold ones, and this is also important. And finally, I will quickly review some examples with cases annotated with silver rationales first. So here we see a case, and we see some other cases. With green background, we see the silver or gold in the rest of the cases rationales, meaning selection of paragraphs. And given the dots, we represent actually the predictions of the models. And here first, we see the results of a baseline model considering only the main sparsity loss, which was pretty much what happened in the literature. So we observe that the model selected the first paragraph, again, including only demographic information. While here, we see the very same example considering the selection from the model using the singularity loss, which has pretty much improved results in rationale quality. But I think it's more interesting to review some examples where our best model using singularity makes mistakes and understand what possibly goes wrong. So in this specific case, we see that paragraphs 11 and 14, annotated by the legal expert for gold to form the gold annotations, indicate that the applicant needs special health treatment, which can take place in prison, and this guy needs to be moved to specialized clinics. But these paragraphs were not selected by our model. Instead, other paragraphs with heavier medical terminology have been selected, although they do not express mistreatment and actually say about examination and other stuff. So in another similar case, we see that paragraph 16 and 19, again, clearly indicate that the applicant's health and life is at risk and authorities do not pay attention. But these paragraphs, again, were not selected by our model. Instead, our model insisted to identify, to select paragraph 10, which states that the applicant initially informed the authorities for his medical history and they provided medication, which is actually pretty much a good thing. And similar to the previous case, we see that there is an indication that the model is kind of sensitive to language describing health issues in general and not specific well-defined allegations for treatment. So in our paper, we also include other interesting examples for other issues that indicate kind of a lack of causality in model selections. And this is me saying that, of course, there is a lot of work to be done in the future. So finally, I conclude this presentation with the main contributions. First and foremost, we introduced this new task considering rationale extraction. I think this is very important. Secondly, we release this data set that you can find in Hugging Face and use it very easily. And also we have an extensive study of the proposed regularizers and the proposal of a new one which has improved results across different qualities. More importantly, I will state some limitations. In the future, I think it will be good to rethink the overall setup. We would possibly like to examine methods that extract more structured explanations, considering also the cross-paragraph relations. And in fact, I have in my mind the words of the legal expert, Dimitrios, who said that actually lawyers kind of follow some factual patterns and try to identify these kind of things. And in this direction, we could possibly follow the work of Abner and Suidema to examine the attention flow of the transformer, which actually try to capture these kind of relationships. Also, my main focus will remain in relation to identification and mitigation of bias, which was kind of underestimated this work. And the main limitation is actually that we didn't estimate how biased are the examined models and how different variants affect this specific aspect. Of course, we would also like to follow techniques that mitigate bias, as you see from the literature, while also I believe that the biasing model is an important countermeasure for fairness, to improve fairness, but also could potentially improve performance or maybe give better or more faithful explanations. So thank you, and I would gladly answer any questions.
Right, thank you very much, Ilias. So, Gijs, would you like to take control now?
Sure. I'm not sure if I'm going to take control, but at least I can provide some comments. So, Ilias, this is amazing work. I really love to see your presentation, but also your paper. It's really impressive, and I think you're really pursuing a nice path. Of course, you're also waiting for some maybe some more critical remarks or some suggestions how to improve this. And I have three avenues that I would like to discuss and share. And these are not so much, I guess, like very practical points that you can immediately include, but these are, I guess, questions that as a community, we need to ask ourselves when we do this type of research and how to improve this type of research, not only from a methodological point of view, but also from an implementation point of view. So three elements. The first one was triggered by the, I guess, like one of your first slides on the heat map, the attention heat map. And it raised the question for me, what are you actually measuring? What are these studies actually measuring? And I think that there's at least two things that kind of concern me here. The first element is this, what we call motivated reasoning. So how these judgments are constructed is that there's a difference between how judges or decision makers come to their decision and how they justify their decision or motivate their decision. There's actually empirical research that shows that sometimes courts or judges, they are very doubting as to like what kind of verdict or decision to make. And they are then ultimately like, for instance, 60% in favor of a certain decision and 40% not in favor of that decision. So they can be hesitant. But when you read those decisions, then it actually looks like it's more like 90-10, that there's hardly any doubt in the decisions. And that's also the feedback you sometimes get from lawyers when they're involved in a case, where the lawyer stayed like, yeah, I read the decision and it doesn't look anything like the case that I presented. And that's because what judges do and decision makers do, they write the decisions down in terms of what the outcome is going to be. So that part of motivated reasoning or the fact selection even, because that's another part of what judges do. They select the facts, and facts that are not relevant or not deemed relevant or facts that do not support the outcome may be left out in the decision, whereas they might appear in the complaints or the things that the lawyers produce, but you don't see them really then in the decision, and that affects things tremendously. So with these types of studies, prediction studies, I mean, I'm doing one myself as well. So the question is also to myself is, what are we really measuring? Are we measuring really what the which facts predict the outcomes ultimately, or which facts are relevant here? Or are we predicting or explaining the facts that the judges use for motivated reasoning, or the facts that they usually select with respect to the outcomes? So I guess like motivated reasoning is can be one of them. And in, I think one of the first slides, you also see that in terms of there were keywords mentioned like police officers, arms and chest, and you also see that in these language-based prediction models that you, Ilias, and also others, I saw Masha here as well, have produced also very interesting studies. The question, however, arises then, like these types of words, do they only occur when there's, for instance, a violation? So do, for instance, courts and judges feel the need or have the urge to kind of explain the article that was violated and the keywords that accompany those violations? Because then it makes sense that they kind of sort of lecture the readers as to which articles are applicable. And that is reflected then in also the words and the language that these courts use. Also very specifically in terms of what are you measuring here? And you I think highlighted it in some of your slides, the country, so the respondent country, that's a very important variable also in these previous language-based models, because when, like, there's some countries that are notoriously bad when it comes to European Court of or human rights violations, basically. Italy, Turkey, Ukraine, Russia are really bad. I think they have a 90-95% or even higher conviction rates. Whereas the good students of the class, Denmark and Germany, they go like to 50%, which means that these language models, whether it's on the word level or on the paragraph level, they must somehow pick up on these elements when there's Russian cities involved or certain keywords that refer to Italy or Italian language. It could be that actually is flagged by the system. And I hope, and I'm curious how you see that. I hope that's part of the biases that you're going to test or would like to test. And a very simple solution for at least the countries is to remove the entities that are countries as a part of the pre-processing. It of course doesn't get rid of everything because there could be other proxies that are involved, but it could be one of the means to kind of improve the models. Further improvement in terms of what are we actually measuring and are we measuring what we want to measure. So that's my first point about the measurement and the validity. What are you measuring here? Then the second point relates to the use of these models and especially the practical use. So I was triggered by one of the sentences in the paper, which read, models of this kind could be used by potential applicants to help them formulate future allegations. And that actually made me wonder whether that's the case. Because one of the important elements here, especially with European Court of Human Rights decisions, but you also see it with the other important Court of Justice of the European Union, the cases only come to that court once national measures are exhausted. So that basically means that you have a court of first instance, a court of appeal, and probably a Supreme Court at the national level who've already looked at these cases, and only then you can move on to the European Court of Human Rights, where there's a big inadmissibility stage part where like the vast majority of cases are already struck out in admissibility stage. So it basically goes to show that are these facts really that relevant in the precedent system, where if you already have a case that decides on similar facts, then that is going to be used as a precedent in future cases. And it makes it very unlikely that such a case with similar facts will actually reach that court, because it will be either decided upon and on the national level. And even if a party decides to go to the European Court of Human Rights, it's very likely that these decisions are going to be struck out in the admissibility stage, as evidenced by the actual numbers. So then the question that I have is, what is then the value? And maybe you should look the value of these types of models in some different domains. And maybe you should consider applying it to lower court cases that require court intervention. So for instance, a labor contract termination, divorce cases in many legal systems, if there's a contract termination of a labor agreement, you have to go to court. And that's interesting because then there's no selection bias. The precedent value is almost zero. And then you actually can compare the facts against the outcomes of the case or predict which rationales are going to be relevant. So I would very much invite you, or at least reflect on whether that would be an interesting avenue to do. Of course, you would have to go into a national system, which means that often you cannot benefit from the English language and the English language models. But I think that would prove a very much value to the stuff that you're doing here. So basically cases that require to go to court. That's one thing. And the other thing is we're focusing on the individual level. So we try to make predictions or explanations on the individual level, meaning that we're trying to say something about an individual case. And I'm wondering, I'm curious about your answer with respect to that, is maybe we should focus on not the individual level, but actually the aggregate level. I always say to my students, the right answer to every exam question on a legal exam is it depends. The context matters, and it's very difficult to actually capture that context. I think where the where computational models come in is maybe not so much on the individual level, but on the aggregate level. So a lawyer can interpret a certain case probably way better than a machine can. But on the aggregate level, if we're talking about hundreds, thousands, or 10,000s of cases, that goes beyond human comprehension. So if you're able to kind of select these rationales and move it to a higher level where you combine it with these and leverage the information across a large number of cases, I think that would make make a lot of sense. And then maybe as a kind of a cheap shot, what's the difference between what you're doing and creating summaries? And maybe that's another interesting avenue to actually explore, because if you're able to identify these rationales, maybe you can also provide for better summarization. And also that would go a very long way. So I'm saying it's a cheap shot, but actually I think it's it could prove valuable for the use. And then my third and last point, I mean, I have some minor points and I can bring them in later, and otherwise I'll put them, I'll direct them to you directly, they're not that important, is of course the causality and correlation discussion. We'll never find a good answer to that. But I'm curious if there's any way to measure causality. And what I find valuable is that you involve experts here, or at least one expert that you have. I'm curious what your thoughts are about creating a sort of a community of experts that can also serve as a baseline or a reference point, or can provide input that can actually update our models so that you sort of have a crowd of experts that together with computational analysis and computational methods can improve the quality of these models. So I'll leave it with that for now. But again, I mean, these are my observations that I hope that you can use them to further improve the research. But in general, I was really impressed by this study. So well done.
Thank you very much, Gijs. So how should we do this? Ilias, would you like to maybe share any thoughts on the points that Gijs made? For example, brief summaries, points about validity, what we are measuring exactly here. Another point was about the possible use. Maybe it's more useful to go to other courts where there's no precedent or selection bias, or maybe work at an aggregate level instead of looking at individual cases. Also the relation, how similar what you're doing is to summarization, and also a point about causality versus correlation. So all these things, would you like to share any thoughts about these?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Thanks, guys, for your comments. All of them are pretty much really, really good. As I would say that maybe I could provide some answers, some thoughts, and maybe also Ion and Nikos could come in and share their thoughts as co-authors. So I will start with your first comment, Gijs, which was about the fact that we actually just have the facts out of the report of the court, which may be actually biased before we even start. So we have a report which actually maybe has phrased the arguments in favor of the judgment, et cetera, et cetera. And I think this is very important that we have this half-baked kind of facts, and this is, I think, really correlated with what I stated in the first part, that actually the data that we have are part of the problem. So if the data are framed in a way that kind of bias a specific position, then we have to deal with this, and this is a big issue, and I wish we had also access to documents that are more kind of representative of the case, so communication, etc., before the case. And I think moving to the question about bias and the fact that as we see in some cases, the model try and takes words from, as you said, specific locations, or kind of here we have a reference in the police or the prosecutor, and all these kind of things bias in the model. I think, of course, that a pretty easy setup would be, as you said, to kind of anonymize the text and try to figure out how this affects performance. in some early experiments, I show that if we anonymize the documents, we have actually a performance drop up to 2 to 3% in microF1, which is kind of important. And it shows that actually these models use this kind of information. We need to do something about that. I think there are kind of interesting approaches to identify these kind of things. In some thoughts, I give that probably we could do some probing tests and see if we can use information from the fine-tuned model to identify kind of sources of bias. As you said, the location of the application, maybe if we have a lot of references in Russian cities or which also kind of, in some cases also, different locations hint the defendant state, etc. This would be kind of important. And then to say something about, as you said, yes, pretty much what we do is pretty similar to extractive summarization in terms of the technology. So this would be also another interesting direction to kind of try to use these techniques to create summaries, especially when we have much larger documents and not just 10 or 20 facts. This would be super interesting. And also I think this is related to the other comment that you made, that maybe if we can extract rationales from previous cases, from precedent, then we can possibly use this to pretty much educate legal scholars, I guess, to give them extra context to make better decisions, to consider more information that they could probably do by themselves by manually reviewing documents. This is my comments. I don't know if I left anything.
Thank you. Gijs, I don't know, do you want to maybe share any follow-up thoughts, or should we also ask other people? How do you prefer to do this?
Yeah, I would say let's ask some other people. I don't want to.
All right. I see at least a few hands. Let's start. Nikos, would you like to? I think you raised your hand first.
Okay, thanks, Ian. Just a quick remark about Gijs' comments, which are very, 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 very useful in terms of how we can inform ourselves and inform our models in order to develop tools that are more useful for the end users, right? And these are legal scholars and people that empirically study law. So taking a step back, I think the aggregates idea is really nice, and I think it's something that I honestly haven't thought before, and it's what people do in social media analysis and other areas of what we call computational social science, or whatever this thing's called, like analyzing large scale analysis in social media to study human behavior and other traits. I think what you said is really important, because, for example, I was thinking while you were saying these things, actually, if you train what we did in a previous paper in 2019 on predicting the outcomes of ECHR, we did this chronological setup on training the model to cases from 1970 to 2018, and then we tested from 2018 to 2020, if I remember correctly, or let's say the periods were slightly different. But I mean, someone, a legal scholar, could use these models to study what are the rationales that are picked by the model on an aggregate level, for example, for violation versus non-violation, or for individual articles, by training the model on, let's say, a smaller period of time, I don't know, in the 50s or in the 60s, from 60s to 80s, and from 80s to 2000, right? And then you can study if there are differences in what the model has identified as more important for making a prediction. So, for example, what are the justifications, and tie it with social norms, or or even like policies, what was the status quo in 1980s, what people were thinking about certain topics, probably, I don't know, well, not torturing, but other behaviors that now we think that are just normal. Back in the 70s, were not normal. We were not considered as normal, probably. I don't know. This is something that we could, a legal scholar, an expert in the field, could use these tools to study. And taking an even step back, related to the very, very valid comment about lower courts cases, studying, of course, this setup that we follow, we know that it's not the ideal one because of all these limitations, the selection bias, we don't have access to the whole data sets. How I see this kind of research is more like developing some types of tools that we show to people that, well, this is a toolbox with some tools that we developed to help you in your studies. And then legal scholar folks, people from the legal domain, should come and say, well, okay, I might use this tool. This tool might be useful. This might not be. And it might even make sense to develop a better tool for studying X or Y. And I think this is why it is really important to communicate as communities in order to improve these models. But if you want to write the aggregates paper, the aggregates analysis paper, that would be really interesting.
Thank you, Nikos. Giovanni, I see your hand raised.
Yes, thank you so much. And I have a very quick question. So thank you so much, because this was really interesting, especially for who has a legal background. Actually, it's really like demystifying some kind of, you know, problems that we address every day. But I would like just to stress a point that maybe it's interesting, you know, when we look especially at decisions, of course, and precisely the decision of the European Court of Human Rights, because I think this is not just important. This work is not just important for end users, you know, for whoever subject will benefit from addressing this data or research. But I think it's also important to understand also some legal concepts, you know, also the meaning, and also to provide a little bit of nuance outside a mere tendency towards legalism. I think that it's important in a way also to, for example, just to provide an example, it's important also to apply this model to the definition of proportionality. This is something where legal scholars are struggling so much to understand how to draft a line between free speech and privacy, for example. How to draft a line and how to understand if there is a consistency in the decisions of, for example, the European Court of Human Rights when it balances fundamental rights. What are the primary factors at stake that maybe, can, of course, strike a different balance? And this is possible looking at data, looking at the narratives, the words that the European Court of Human Rights use. So to understand if there is a bias, not in just in the technology, but also in the way judges address some problems. If they try to overprotect, for example, the right to free speech, if they want to protect more, people against discrimination and so forth. So I think that this analysis is very important also to understand broadly also legal concepts. And so I think it's really fascinating when we look at that. And so I was really long. Just to say that I would be really curious to see more of this research to go towards that direction, towards help lawyers, you know, legal scholars, to understand more about what is behind the letter of the law, the black letter of the law.
Thank you. Masha, you had a question to ask?
I have also a comment on some previous things. First of all, super interesting. Thank you very much. I read the paper as well. Methodologically, I really liked it. I have a sort of agree with Heise's ideas on sort of the purpose of the task, that it's maybe more on a scientific part rather than actually individuals can use it, because, well, when the applicant applies to the court, of course, they have to mention the article first and then describe the facts. And this also actually tells us that these documents technically exist. So if a European Court of Human Rights actually wanted to develop something like this, there are documents that have article and explanation. That's only part, of course, one thing to remember there, that it's of course only arguments of the victim. and then there is investigation. So this is also sort of why, I would agree that the final documents are not always great, even if they don't remove some of the facts. So like Gijs mentioned that they might sort of phrase it in a certain way. We're sort of actually trying to figure out whether that's true, but either way, there's a whole investigation in the middle, right? So, but in terms of like understanding what kind of language there is, it might be interesting, but I think like with this specific court, what would be really nice is just to take what you've done and apply it to the arguments of the court. And then you can actually have rationale of the court instead of sort of the phrasing like in the facts per se, because it also, as far as I understand, these facts are also not written by judges. The arguments like reflect of what judges say a lot better than these facts, because the facts are compiled mostly by the registries of different countries and so on. So, but I think like this, from what I understood from methodology, that could really apply really beautifully on the facts of the on the arguments of the court. So that's just a comment. My question is more on it's not entirely clear to me why you want to remove the bias, because if you're not if you're predicting decisions but not making decisions, it's not so basically if Russia is a notorious violator of the same human right over and over again in the same prison in the same city, and it's true. So why not use this information to try to predict decisions? So again, if you make decisions, I understand that you should not maybe use this kind of information, but if you're predicting decisions, that to me it does not sound like necessarily a big issue, but maybe you have some other ideas. That's
thank you very much. Ilias, any thoughts? Or Gijs, any thoughts?
Yeah, sure.
So please, if you have any questions, please raise your hands or write them here in the chat.
So, yes, may I comment on Masa's comment? Yes, as you said, probably a model that has access to kind of the current facts that actually show that probably Russia is really bad in kind of how they handle human rights, maybe it's important. But I think in case of what we want really to do and to identify pretty much some kind of causal explanation why this guy was right or not, maybe we would like both ways. Maybe we would need a model which is biased and we see these biases in full-fledged and find that, okay, yes, this kind of city is very notorious for having people who were beaten by the police, et cetera, et cetera. But also in another direction, maybe we want to kind of make something which is more causal and say that, okay, the important thing is that this guy was beaten and not that the fact that this guy was beaten in this specific city. So as I said, in very early, both identifying bias with this kind of model is important because this is how we move further and we say that there is bias and we need to do something about it to mitigate whatever. And of course, then we need to do something to kind of fix our models probably because we don't want to hold the legacy of our ancestor. As Nico said, maybe guys in the 80s think that it's a bad thing to have a specific kind of behavior and now it's acceptable. So we don't need to follow our legacy, our bad legacy actually. And also another comment that you already said, yes, maybe we would use also some other kind of information like the arguments. We can actually kind of extract arguments from the parts and use them as well. We could also use case law and try to also predict case law and build tools to kind of identify relevant case law. And maybe then if we have all of these things together, maybe we could have something which has a more holistic point of view. And just to comment, I forget completely to comment or case comments on going to lower courts. I think this is a great idea, first and foremost, because I think the current formulation with ECHR is really simple. You have pretty much very simple things, very, let's say, concrete and understandable kind of human rights and how they are violated. While if we go to lower courts, maybe there we have a complete mess of arguments and very specific accusations and very tricky situations. And we will see probably that our models there are even worse on what they do, and there is a much a larger scope of future work.
Thank you. I have been informed that we have at least one judge in the audience, so I was hoping that we could hear maybe some thoughts of judges or people who are directly involved in decision making in courts. Any thoughts?
Ion, just to add that Gijs had to go.
Yes.
Another commitment.
Okay. Yes, I saw that. Yes. Yep. And I thanked him also. Hi.
I'm not sure whether there are other judges. Hi, everybody.
Hello.
Catalina, probably you're putting me on the spot, I guess.
Yes, so, I did. Just did.
Yeah. Happy to comment. This is all very, very interesting. And I think the idea of having an analysis at an aggregate level is most certainly something we will see in the near future. I think that is probably the most important. And I think that will allow to make in a certain way what you could call a synthetic judge, and will help us analyze our own case law and understand whether there are, confront an individual decision with the aggregate and see whether there are inconsistencies, whether we have forgotten something, whether we have changed our opinion because the facts are really different or because time has evolved, the way we look at the law has evolved. So that is one of the comments I would like to make. And then for the rest, thank you for a very interesting paper. I really enjoyed it, Ilias.
Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot.
Any other questions or points from the audience?
I have a question, if I may, until maybe Jerry can think also about a question, perhaps. But I have a question about maybe you, if you could elaborate a little bit on the annotation framework. That's pretty much the question.
Yeah, sure. So, as I said, the first part of annotation is actually right there in the documents. So we just made an assumption that if the judges actually, or whoever write down the opinion, use some references in between the words, then probably these references highlight the most prominent facts out of the others that may don't have the same impact. So this kind of the silver line for us. And then we just wanted to validate if actually the silver annotations are pretty much of a reasonable quality. And this is why we also asked a law expert to do the annotation of the of a subset of 50 cases. I would say that the guidelines was pretty much written very quickly. We discussed with a legal expert, Nikos and me, how we should possibly frame this kind of thing. And we just offered him the case facts. And then we asked him to tell us his opinion of what happened in this case. So he didn't know actually what were the allegations and the violations. So he had to predict himself. And also, he had to kind of justify his own opinion with kind of saying this fact is important, this is not. And we tried to pretty much frame it as better as we could and say that if a specific fact is completely relevant to this specific accusation, then annotate it. If you have second thought, don't do that. So keep the most important for your personal opinion. So this was pretty much the framework. And we saw that if you see the results, we have pretty much a little bit better performance if we compare with the lawyer's annotation, I would say. probably because these annotations are of better quality, of course. But I would say also that the silver annotations are important because they could use in various and several ways to do further research or to find any other interesting aspect.
Thanks, Ilias. Vasilis, I see you have a question.
Yes, thank you very much. A really interesting presentation, especially for us with a legal background. I would like to build a bit on the previous comments. To be honest, it's a bit hard to put vague notions like proportionality, the one was mentioned before, into such a perspective. But it would be really interesting, and I would like to build on the previous thought about lower courts. Would it be possible to have, in order to have more immediate practical examples of such applications, to use them in contexts that could be like more quantifiable? Either, I mean, calculate the compensation for cases like accidents or decide to which parent would the custody go to. This is because to me, I think that the European Court of Human Rights decisions, besides dealing with broad concepts like proportionality, for example, or with human rights and the issues that come alongside this, I mean, like the fair trial issues and things like that, I think it would be really interesting to try to address fields of law that have a less objective prism in the meaning and a more universal approach, since the European Court of Human Rights deals with cases from lots of different systems that by definition have a different approach to the even the notions that the European Court comes to make its judgments on. Thank you.
Thank you. Ilias or anybody else, further thoughts?
I would say in general, any other kind of application of this kind of technology in other cases, in other use cases with different courts, with different kind of objective is interesting. As far as we can have data to work on, I mean, I'm totally open for this. I hope there are, and we don't know yet.
Okay, a mini advertisement. If you haven't joined the Slack of NLLP, there's a link here on the chat. Please consider joining. It's a kind of a discussion forum where we discuss things related to the workshop and legal NLP. Anybody else who would like to ask a question or share a thought? If not, I don't know if the other co-organizers of the seminar would like to add something.
Daniel, are you there? Do you want to add anything?
No, nothing on my side.
Okay.
Yeah, I just wanted to say thank you. A really wonderful presentation. Thank you, everyone, for joining. I think it would be really nice to explore also this more interdisciplinary part of law and natural language processing. I see Nikos also has something else to say.
Just a quick question or like a suggestion. Shall we make our next presentation more legal oriented? Someone from the legal domain or like empirical legal domain?
Yes, and if anybody here has,
I agree totally.
If people have suggestions, please do let us know. The idea is to have people from both sides, let's say, both the computational side and from the sort of more legal side. Ideally, people working on both, of course, both sides.
People they want to present their papers.
Yes. Okay. So I don't see any other comments here or raised hands. So I guess it's time to thank you all once again. And I think this completes our discussion today. Thank you very much for joining.